Now let us understand, friends, what is purpose of a business. So if we have to understand ethics, if we have to understand, we have to practice ethics, if we have to practice good corporate governance, if we have to follow good professional standards, which we are supposed to, because that is the expectation of the government of India from all the professionals, let alone the evaluation professionals, from all the professionals, this is the expectation of the country as a whole, from every one of us, that we follow highest standards of professional ethics. We follow good corporate governance. And if we have to understand that, we need to understand as to what is the purpose of a business. Now, friends, I'm sure if I asked you this question as to what is the purpose of a business, I'm sure you will have definitely many answers. And I can understand those answers are going to be differing. Many of you might say that the purpose of a business is to make profit. Now, this is what I have experienced all over the world, wherever I have delivered these programs. And I have delivered these programs in more than 50 locations across the globe. Most people would think that the purpose of a business is to make profit. And let me tell you, friends, that's not correct. That's not correct. And why do I say that it's not correct? Because if the purpose of a business was to make profit, you would not see a company called Apple. Why? Because the founders of Apple, Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak, within the first few years of their operations, they started making profit. And they would have said that the purpose of a business is to make profit. We have made profit. Purpose is achieved. Let us close the business. If the purpose of a business was to make profit, we would not see this group called Tata's that we have spoken about. Why? Because as I said a little while ago, Jamshedji Tata had earned enough money before he even thought of putting up a steel plant. And he would have said, I have earned enough money. The purpose of a business is to make profit. I have earned enough profit. Purpose is achieved. Let us close the business. If the purpose of a business was to make profit, you and I would not see a company called Apple's or company called Google. Why? Because a company called Microsoft. Why? Because Microsoft or Google, the founders of these companies made profit within very first few years of their operations. And they would have said, purpose of a business is to make profit. We have earned profit. Purpose is achieved. Let us close the business. So please remember, friends, the purpose of a business is not to make profit. And why do I say that the purpose of a business is not to make profit? And that is because making profit in a business is compulsory. Making profit in a business is mandatory. Making profit in a business is not a matter of choice. Making profit in a business is not a matter of an option. Making profit in a business is non-negotiable. Meaning what? Meaning if you are in business, you better make profit. If you are in business, you better make profit. And that is the reason why I say that the purpose of a business is not to make profit. And that is because making profit in business is mandatory. Making profit in business is compulsory. Making profit in business is non-negotiable. Non-negotiable. Then what is the purpose of a business? And remember, the purpose of a business is to create value. Purpose of a business is to create value by making profit, or make profit by creating value. And that is what, friends, we need to understand very, very clearly as to what is the purpose of a business. And it is not to make profit. It is to create value. So you make profit by creating value, or you create value by making profit. Doesn't really matter. Either way, it is perfectly okay. But the making profit is not the purpose of a business. And please remember, you can understand and think about it. You will definitely get it. Anywhere, anyone whose only focus was making profit, that person will indulge into all kinds of wrong practices. And such people then will have to sit in London. So Vijay Mallya or Nirav Modi or so many of them, their focus was on making profit by hook or crook. But the real purpose of a business is to create value by making profit, or make profit by creating value. So the focus has to be on value creation. The focus has to be on value creation. So if in my profession, if I'm focusing on value creation, if the business is focusing on value creation, ethics are followed automatically. ethics are followed automatically. Ethics are followed automatically. And that is what we need to understand. So the moment your focus is on creating value. And what is the meaning of creating value? Meaning of creating value, friends, is very simple. Meaning of creating value is to make this world a better place to live today than what it was yesterday. And as simple as that. So are we doing in our practice or are we doing in our business things which are making this world a better place to live? If we are doing that, we are by default following the ethics. But if we are doing things which are only to help us personally and not to help the economy as a whole or country as a whole or society as a whole, then we are not pursuing the ethics. And the moment we understand as to what is the purpose of a business and the moment we try to imbibe it, ethics are, friends, automatically taken care of. And what is the relationship between the purpose of a business, ethics, and good corporate governance or professional standards? Again, friends, is very simple. So the moment a business is working to create value, the moment a professional is working to create value, that means to help his clients take better decisions, right? Then ethics are automatically pursued. But if a professional is indulging in undercutting, If a professional is indulging in mandate snatching, if a person is indulging in wrong practices, trying to bribe someone or trying to accept bribe from someone, he might make more money, he might make some money. But remember, ethics are gone. Ethics are gone completely. And that is what we need to remember, that as a professional, our obligation is to set example, set right kind of example. Remember, if after becoming a professional, if I cannot follow the ethics, then my becoming a professional is of zero value. Because if it was only a matter of feeding myself and my family, uneducated people can also do. People who have no education can also do, and they do. So having become a qualified professional, if I cannot adhere to the ethics, if I cannot become an example of ethics, then my becoming a professional is of zero value, So I need to understand the relationship between the ethics and the purpose of a business or purpose of a profession and the good governance. And it is very simple that as a professional, I have an obligation. And what is an obligation? Obligation is, as a professional, I have to think in terms of everyone. As a professional, I cannot afford to think only for myself. And remember, and that is the reason as to why I'm a professional. And that is the relationship between the professionals, ethics, and purpose of a business. And please remember, why do I say that the purpose of a business is not to make profit? Why do I say that in a business you have to make profit? And that is because if you are not making profit in a business by creating value, then you are harming the entire economy. Because the loss that you're making in your business, remember, is draining the resources of the economy. And since the resources of the economy are being drained, you are being a burden, you are being a liability, your business is being a burden, your business is being a liability. And therefore, if a person cannot make profit by creating value in his business, the least that he can do is to close that business and give it to somebody who can run it profitably. And as a matter of fact, all of us know that today there's a law also. And this law, insolvency in bankruptcy code, is what? This law, insolvency in bankruptcy code, is nothing but, in case if a business is not making profit, then this business has to close down. Why? Because if a business is not making profit, he will not pay to his creditors, the financial creditors or the operational creditors. If he is not making payment to his financial creditors, operational creditors, they will go to NCLT, file an application against the company, and this company application will be admitted, and the management and the promoters will have to go away, and the business will be given to somebody. And that is what we need to understand and remember. Friends, one more reason as to why all of us need to follow ethics. One more reason as to why all of us need to follow ethics. Number one, because we want to become an example. And number two, just imagine what kind of society we will have if no one follows ethics एंड गुड गवर्नेंस प्रैक्टिस. इमेजिन करिए, इस दुनिया में सब लोग बेईमान हैं, सब लोग चोर हैं, सब लोग बदमाश हैं, सब लोग डाकू हैं. व्हाट विल हैपन ऑन दिस अर्थ, यू कैन जस्ट इमेजिन. एंड व्हाट काइंड ऑफ, इन दैट केस, व्हाट काइंड ऑफ वर्ल्ड वी विल बी लीविंग बिहाइंड फॉर नेक्स्ट जनरेशन विद दैट. एंड दैट इज व्हाट वी नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड एंड रिमेंबर. सो वी प्रोफेशनल्स हैव अ मच बिगर रोल इन सेटिंग द कल्चर ऑफ गुड बिजनेस एथिक्स and high professional standards. And friends, that is the reason as to why the government of India thought, among other things, to also make rules for the purpose of valuation. So it's not that the valuations were not being done before 2017 in this country. Valuations were being done, but they were involving all kinds of wrong practices. And remember, whenever there are wrong practices, someone gets unfair advantage and someone gets unfair disadvantage. And both the things are wrong. And that's the reason why the government of India thought of bringing out the valuation rule and the valuation exam. Because the government of India, please remember, through the valuation rule has posed tremendous amount of trust and confidence in we professionals. Government of India ko laga ki this job can be done very well by qualified and competent professionals like chartered accountants, cost accountants, company secretaries, MBAs, lawyers, architects, engineers, and so on and so forth. And since the government of India has posed this onus, this responsibility on every one of us, on the shoulder of every one of us, we obviously have to discharge this responsibility and this ownership in the best possible way. And from that perspective, there are, of course, model code of conduct for the registered valuers. But friends, I would like to mention here that the model code of conduct, which we're going to discuss now for the registered valuers, really speaking, there should not be a need for a document like this. Really speaking, there should not be a need for a document like this. Why? Because if all the professionals do what they're supposed to be doing, then there is no need to have a document model code of conduct. But the model code of conduct has to be brought out as part of the valuation rules so as to ensure that the practicing valuation professionals at least adhere to something which is bare minimum. Now, here I would also like to tell you, friends, under this model code of conduct, there are 8 different headings under which 29 different clauses have been inserted so as to ensure that we professionals, we valuation professionals, adhere to those clauses of model code of conduct. And that is to ensure there is a minimum compliance with the ethics. But what is our responsibility? What is our duty? What is our obligation? Our duty, our obligation, our responsibility is not to look at the model code as to how to comply with these 28 clauses. Our responsibility, our obligation, our duty is to go much beyond that. And that is our conduct, our behavior, our approach, our attitude, as far as the ethics are concerned, should be such that we never have to refer and see as to what is given in the model code of conduct. So what is given in the model code of conduct should automatically be part of our approach and behavior and life in general. But we have to also understand it from the perspective of the exam, because I understand all of you are also writing your valuation exam. So there will be some questions that you would have coming from model code of conduct. And so not only we have to understand as to what is given in the model code of conduct so that we are able to practice it when we become a qualified valuation professional, but we also need to look at the model code of conduct so as to ensure that whatever questions are coming in the exam, we are able to answer those questions appropriately. Now, so we will now shift and switch to switch our discussion and look at the model code of conduct for the registered valuers. But before I do that, in case if you would like to say something, in case you would like to add something, in case you would like to contribute something to whatever that I have discussed with you, please go ahead. First, we will take your points and then we will start looking at the model code of conduct for the registered valuers. Over to all of you.